Mr. Toby Lenzer, Assistant Secretary General in EUMAM, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
For the first question, I want to have your assessment of the current humanitarian situation in Afghanistan. I mean, what the UN sees in Afghanistan, the current situation?
I think the situation is difficult at the moment. You know, since the beginning of 2016, we've had 850,000 people who have had to flee from their homes inside the country. So there are great challenges which exist all over the country, but in particular in parts of the north and parts of the east. And on this World Humanitarian Day, the 19th of August, we want to shine a light not only on people's suffering, but also on the work that is ongoing with the authorities of Afghanistan to make sure that people who are affected by conflict get the help that they need.
Yeah, so what have been your help for these people? What have been your work for these people, especially in the last year?
Well, I think different types of help. We're certainly engaged in terms of providing people healthcare, and that's a major theme for us at the moment, because this World Humanitarian Day has a theme, and the theme is civilians are not a target. I'm very worried that here in Afghanistan over the last years, non-state actors in particular have targeted civilians and in particular medical personnel. So when we, the aid workers, have been on the front lines trying to help the Afghan authorities keep clinics open, keep hospitals open, it's particularly important that people recognize their responsibilities, that the parties to the conflict recognize their responsibilities to protect people, to ensure that medical personnel are always safe, and to help aid workers reach those people who do require help.
Are there any priorities, like you said, some parts of the country in the north and also especially in Kunduz and Helmand provinces during the last months? Are there any priorities to help these people more and first?
Well, for example, just recently, thanks to the Common Humanitarian Fund, in my role as the humanitarian coordinator, I was able to allocate $25 million so that non-governmental organizations, in particular those from here, from Afghanistan, can reach people in places that are very remote, places where there has been violence and the violence has driven the authorities or even the United Nations and other organizations into difficult times. And difficult times, of course, means that children, boys and girls, suffer. Men and women are suffering. And so whether it's a bit of food or a bit of shelter, whether it's running a clinic to make sure that children can have access to a doctor when they get ill, or making sure that it's a polio campaign to eradicate this terrible disease from Afghanistan. You know, we are there on the front lines, standing side by side with the people in need here in Afghanistan.
How about the funding? Do you have enough funding for this humanitarian aid? I think that your organization has got only 30% of the fund that it required from the world.
I think, you know, there's never enough money in any line of work, whether we're looking at development cooperation or emergency response. NGOs and UN agencies working side by side with the Ministry of Health or the Ministry of Education, none of us ever have enough. And that's why we do need to prioritize and we need to focus. And so on the humanitarian side of our work, we try to focus where we feel need is the highest. That tends to be in places where the violence is most acute. And one of the messages for World Humanitarian Day, this 19th of August 2017, one of our messages is, whether you're a state or a non-state actor, it is your responsibility to protect people, to enable health workers to carry out their programs, to make sure that an ambulance is never attacked, and to make sure that aid workers can reach people who need protection and assistance the most.
So this is the biggest message of this day?
It's the biggest message of the day. Civilians are not a target.
And what kind of impact do you think that the day will have and this message will have? Do you think that it will help protect civilians in Afghanistan?
Well, we're making headway, and I think that here in UNAMA, for example, we have an entire team dedicated to protection of civilians, and we know that over the course of time, non-state actors in particular, but also other forces partaking in the violence for the sake of peace and security, they have become more sensitive to the fact that civilians should not be targeted, to the fact that medical establishments have to stay open, even in the most difficult moments. And some people have looked at me and said, but what do you expect? There's a lot of violence, there's a conflict. I mean, things can go wrong. I want to remind everybody on this World Humanitarian Day that all parties to conflict have the responsibility to protect civilians. All parties to a conflict, they are not allowed to target civilians. And so over time, I hope that this message resonates more and more. We in the United Nations, with our partners and with the authorities of this beautiful country, will be working harder to make sure that every boy and every girl, every man and every woman has the best chance to stay alive and to prosper throughout a healthy life.
Did you face any other problems like corruption when you are working with local officials or other organizations? Because this is a big problem in Afghanistan, and many NGOs are concerned about that.
I think many people are concerned about that in lots of different countries. Yeah. And of course, whether it's in my own country or in your country, this is something that we work on. We have part of the United Nations working very closely with His Excellency President Ashraf Ghani and the Chief Executive Abdullah Abdullah to try to reduce the impact of corruption on every walk of life. But I would say that when it comes to humanitarian aid, what we are fortunate to be benefiting from is that when it comes to life-saving assistance, when it comes to that quick response to a flood or to an avalanche, when it comes to making sure that clinic is working in times of real trouble, or a vaccinator wants to reach people just outside Kunduz to make sure that no other children get polio, we want to make sure that we can do our work just the best we can.
And about the sustainable development goals in Afghanistan, the experts say that Afghanistan is not even near to these goals because of the security situation and also because of the corruption. What do you say about that? When will Afghanistan get to these goals?
We're working on it very, very closely with the Ministry of Economy and with other authorities, with governors and with mayors across the country.
Do you see any developments?
Well, the goals were just launched in the past months. And so I think it's unfair to say, you know, how much progress have we made. The goals are a very important marker for countries such as Afghanistan in two ways. One is, of course, we want to eradicate poverty. And I think that this is a goal that all Afghans share. We want to help the Afghans have a future which is brighter and more prosperous for your children. The other aspect here on World Humanitarian Day is, what is the link between emergency response and the long-term development aspirations of Afghans? And there I think we can bridge these two initiatives better. I think that humanitarian response can make a greater impact if indeed it not only helps people stay alive, but it helps them have a much brighter and safer tomorrow.
And what are your plans for the, especially for this year, for 2011? Do you have any specific plans for, especially for the displaced people?
Well, we do, and we're working very closely via a new and very exciting mechanism called DIREC, where we have people from embassies, from government institutions, the non-governmental sector, as well as the United Nations, looking at certain provinces. I was just in Herat myself, but I've also been to Mazar, I've been to Jalalabad, Kandahar, and lots of other areas of Afghanistan to really try to see, what is it that displaced communities need to get home? And how can we help? How can UNAMA help? Work with the authorities to calm tensions, to forge peace and security. What is it that we can do to make sure that children have access to schools? What is it that we can do to make sure that people are ready for the winter when that cold temperature bites hard? So there are certain priorities. They're well articulated and calibrated with the authorities, and we're very much looking forward to continuing to stand with the people of this country.
So you mean this embassies and your other partners will have commitments, funding commitments for these people?
Absolutely. There are very firm funding commitments for development cooperation, also for humanitarian action. And I think that tightening the link between those and making sure that they fall within the framework of the Afghan peace and development framework is going to be ever more important. So on this World Humanitarian Day, the 19th of August, I think that remembering that civilians are not a target is crucial. But remembering also that for a better tomorrow, we need much more than that. We need peace and security. We need jobs and other areas where the international community, I'm sure, will continue to stand with the people of Afghanistan.
Can you tell us which was the challenging province in Afghanistan when do you work in them? I mean, which province you had the most and biggest problems and challenges?
I think at the moment one of the biggest challenges is for the people who are returning to Afghanistan. We've got over 600,000 people who came from Pakistan to Afghanistan last year. A signal of hope, a signal of aspiration for a better future. And so that challenged the authorities and the United Nations and non-governmental organizations. We continue to work very hard to make sure that returnees, as we call them, the people who have come back, that they could, thanks to the work of the authorities, have access to land. Thanks to the work of the authorities, make sure that the children can get into school. And so many, many thousands of people who have returned are in places such as Jalalabad or Nangarhar. They're further north in areas such as Kunduz, and many have come to Kabul, as I'm sure you're aware. So ensuring their safety, their access to basic services, but also that they are prepared to weather the winter is part of a, I would say, a comprehensive approach of humanitarian and development programming within an overall aspiration of peace, security amongst all communities in Afghanistan for a better tomorrow, as I said.
And as the last
one more question,
as the last question, you have worked in many different places like Georgia, Russia, and Sudan.
Yes.
Do you see any differences in working in these places about humanitarian aids?
Do you know, every place is unique, and yet there are similarities between different countries. I remember when I first flew into Kabul and I saw the snow-capped mountains, and it reminded me of Georgia. I remember thinking in several meetings that the challenges we're facing to make sure that every boy and every girl can get to school, those are challenges that so many countries face. One of the blessings that I have felt here over my first 5 months in the country is that the commitment of the authorities, the commitment of the people of Afghanistan is very strong. So I am not only optimistic, I think I'm realistic when I say a better tomorrow is possible. To get there, we need to make sure that there is less fighting. We need to make sure that civilians are not a target. And we need to make sure that medical personnel, teachers in schools, are always helped and welcomed to do their work, as should be people who come here to help you build your country.
Mr. Tobelinzer, thank you very much.
Thank you very, very much. Thank you.
You're
thank
welcome.
You. Tashakkur.
Tashakkur.